Okay, it's time for Money Love, and remember, this is our show where we talk about all things money and how to handle our money better and how to do better when it comes to managing our money. I'm Frida Souza, thank you for joining us. Now, last week we talked about real estate and buying a home and managing your home loan. Now we're going to talk about buying versus renting, because a lot of you wrote back saying that's something you're really interested in. You want to know what that calculation is or how to make the decision between buying and renting. So that's what we're going to focus on this week. And we will try and bring in some calculations as well. But the idea is to just understand the various aspects that, you know, that involve making that decision. But before we go forward, remember, call out to our partners on the show, Frio, a brand new digital banking experience. It includes products that help you save money, get access to credit, improve your credit history, shop better. Check out Frio, they're our partners on this show. Now, coming to buying a home, remember we talked a little bit about this in the previous episode, about the fact that buying a home in India tends to be an emotional decision per se, right? You're thinking, you know, you don't want to move as much, it's nice to have a home, it's something your parents pester you about from a really young age, saying, you know, you should save your money, buy a home, and there's this idea of when you pay rent, this money is sort of just getting lost. Whereas if you pay EMI, it's going towards an investment. Also, Indians traditionally always believe that if the investment is something tangible, so like gold that I can actually touch and feel, or a home which you can actually experience, then it's more real than your virtual investments like your mutual funds or your stock market. I do believe and I do understand that younger people don't believe that anymore. In fact, if you go through a lot of the news articles that have been written recently, and we'll show some of that on your screen, a lot of younger people or a lot of millennials prefer not to buy homes. They prefer to rent because the outgo is lower and they save money that can then be used really to invest in the long term. So you actually pay lower rent, you live on rent, and you use the money to buy stocks or mutual funds, and you prefer that investment to locking up your money in a home. But the question that we're going to ask is, if you are going to buy and if you're faced with that decision, how do you make that judgment? And we're going to try and do that calculation today and try and decide between renting and buying. Now, first of all, let's take a look at some of the advantages and disadvantages of both, right? So obviously there are the emotional reasons which we talked about last week. It's a checkbox, especially for Indians, that you get a job, you graduate, you get a job. You buy a house, you get married, vaguely in that order. So it's something that people expect you to do. So that's an emotional decision, really, to be able to live in your own house, to do the Griha Pravesh, to have your name on the board. These are all things that matter and shouldn't be dismissed. So there are the emotional reasons. Then, of course, there's the stability for family. Remember, in India, normally, and this is my experience at least, when you rent a home, they don't like you to stay for too long. So after 2 years, they'll be like, okay, now, you know, we don't give the same house to the same tenant for a very long time. We need you to move out, or we're increasing the rent, or they come up with some reason to get you to move. And I would hate having to move on a regular basis. I despised it, having to, like, you know, just pack everything, look for another house, move it. I hate that process. It was one of the things that I really disliked about living on rent. The other thing is, of course, when you buy your own house, there's some control you have over the environment. You can make some modifications in the house. You have a say in how the building is run. You're part of the, you know, the building society. It gives you a sense of permanence because you're not moving as much. So you can put roots down, especially if you're someone who's starting a family, who's getting married. You can, like, you've got a space that is now yours and you're not going to have to uproot on a regular basis. And that's nice. Also, when you buy a house, you get a slice of the real estate market. And, you know, you'll always have these stories of, oh, isne matlab 30 lakh mein khareede, abhi 1 crore ka ho gaya. So there are always these stories about how real estate has moved up. Now, it's not that simple, of course. You remember that real estate moving up depends on several things. It depends on the economy. And we know our economy has been taking a beating over the last couple of years. It depends on demand and supply, how much unsold inventory there is in the city, how many jobs that, you know, that city is attracting, how many people are coming in to work in that city, what your rental income might be, all of those things, right? It's not a straight up that everybody who buys a house is just going to see appreciation. Also, that appreciation will happen over the period of 10, 15, 20 years. And so technically, if you break it down and compare it to the stock market, it's not shockingly different in terms of return. But what it is that there's a certain level of permanence and illiquidity and inflexibility in buying a house. So there is, of course, you do get a slice of the real estate market if you do buy a house, but it depends on all of these things. Like, for example, Bangalore and Pune have, if you take a look at Bangalore and Pune, say, about 20 years ago, and where it is today, the number of jobs that were created there, the number of people who moved to these cities to work, and then the real estate that was built to cater to these people, and the increase in prices that you saw. So all of these factors play into the increase in prices, but it is safe to say that real estate does go up with time. You see blips, like right now, given COVID and the bad economy and the bad job market, there are some portions of some cities that have just not gone up at all. But over a period of time, if you take 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, research tells us that these homes do in fact go up. In fact, there's some research that says that, compounded annual growth rate, or the average annual growth rate in a Bangalore, is about 8%, or is about 10% on an average. So, you know, it'll just keep chugging along because it continues to remain a city that attracts a certain level of business and creates a certain number of jobs. Now let's take a look at, and of course, when you buy a house, you get tax benefits. You also get tax benefits when you pay rent and you stay on rent. Let's take a look at some of the disadvantages, and this is something to consider. One is, of course, it's inflexible. A lot of us have jobs that require us to maybe move cities, or maybe you want to change jobs that require you to move cities. Once you buy a home, you sort of put down roots, and then that becomes complicated. It's not impossible, but it becomes complicated. You're inflexible. You're now, you've got an asset that requires management. It's not like a mutual fund, or it's not like a fixed deposit. You put your money in and you don't need to manage it anymore. This requires active management. Houses need to be tended to. They need to be fixed. They need to be painted. You can't just lock it up and leave it and go. And that's inefficient because you have to either put it on rent, which is also, you know, not always a very pleasant thing to do. So if you have a job that requires you to move cities, it's not ideal. It becomes a bit of a pain for you to manage. Your money is locked in for the length of the loan, right? So you're committed to pay a large amount of your salary as EMI for 15 years or 20 years or 30 years. And that's a huge commitment. It means then it draws on your ability to quit your job whenever you want to, because you're like, hey, I have this EMI, I can't do this. You can't move cities. You can't decide to quit and do a startup, something that we like to do at this age, because you're committed to pay a certain amount of money as EMI month on month for a certain number of years. Also, you've committed to the value of that property, right? So take, for example, if you buy a home at, say, 1 crore rupees, right? And you've taken a home loan on that money, and unfortunately, for whatever reason, the price of that home either does not go up, or the price of homes in that neighborhood actually comes down. It will not change the fact that you are paying home loans, you're paying your home loan on that 1 crore rupee price, even if the prices come down now. So you are making, you're sort of taking a punt on that price and saying, I'm going to take this and I'm going to assume that A, I do better and the house does better over a period of time. So that's a bit of a risk that you're taking as well. Plus, there are all of the other expenses. There's maintenance that you have to pay. You're constantly fixing stuff. There is like this, property tax that you have to pay. When you buy the house, there will be brokerage. There will be stamp duty. All of these other sort of expenses that also have to be paid when you become a homeowner. And of course, it's inflexible because unlike other investments, if we compare them, unfortunately, apples to oranges, if you compare, say, a mutual fund or stocks or any other investment that you buy, you can sell it in T+2, which is 2 days. You sell a mutual fund, 2 days later, the money is in your account. It is not that easy. It's not easy at all, in fact, to liquidate real estate. If you want to sell your home, it takes a very long time. Also, if you want to foreclose your home loan, it takes a really long time. It's not something banks enjoy doing, so they make it really difficult for you to do. Even if you want to, say, rent out the home, it takes time, it takes energy. There's some like a new coat of paint and you'll be doing a lot of work on it. And, you know, so it's unlike other sort of investments. This one is a little cumbersome to manage, and that's something that you need to keep in mind when you're making that decision. So these are, you know, broad strokes of the advantages and the disadvantages of owning a home vis-a-vis renting a home. Renting, it keeps your costs low in comparison. It keeps you flexible. You can move whenever you want to. You can exit that rent agreement whenever you want to. You can move cities. You can decide to take a larger house, you know, with higher rent, or to take a smaller house with lower rent, depending on whatever is going on in your life. And I do understand for young people that flexibility is something they value a great deal. So these are the advantages and disadvantages in my mind. All right, so let's take a look at the money aspect. Now, I've worked on a spreadsheet. I must put out a disclaimer, guys. Hang on, let me stop. Put out a disclaimer. I'm able to do this because I took a class on how to do this when I was much younger. I'm not really very, very good. I just want to do this to show you broad strokes of how this works and how you make this calculation. But if you're actually going to buy a house, it makes absolute sense to get a chartered accountant or someone who works in accounts to do the calculation for you, because they'll be able to do a much better job than what I have done. This is really broad estimates, broad strokes, to give you an illustration of how you can arrive at your answer, right? So don't judge me. It's been a while since I was in that class. So this is what we've done. This is my calculation, right? So if let's assume, and these are all assumptions, guys, this house that I'm referring to doesn't really exist. Let's assume there is a flat that you can rent for 40,000 bucks a month. If you were to buy it, it would cost you 1 crore rupees. Now, that's my first assumption. Let's take a look at the rent that you're paying. At 40,000 rupees a month, if you're in the 30% tax bracket, which most people are, if you're paying that kind of rent, then you're saving about 30% to 40,000, and your outgo is 28,000 rupees a month. And so we work then on your annual outgo. Your annual outgo, if I'm not mistaken, is about 3.3 lakh. And let's say we're looking at this whole thing in a 20-year horizon. So we're saying this house now that would cost you 40,000 rupees to rent and 1 crore rupees to buy. Let's see what happens if you rented it entirely for 20 years or if you bought it and paid the EMI for 20 years. So if you rented it entirely for 20 years, minus the tax benefit that you get because you have HRA, your final outgo, and I've taken a 10% increase because landlords like to increase that amount on a regular basis, your entire outgo on rent at the end of 20 years, if you stayed in the same flat, would be closer to 2.1 crore rupees, right? Put a pin in that. Now, let's take a look at the other side, which means if you were to buy that same house at 1 crore rupees, which means you would pay a down payment of 20 lakh rupees, which is also something you'd have to have handy if you were to buy a house, and you would borrow 80 lakh rupees from the bank, or you'd be allowed to borrow 80 lakh rupees from the bank. I've taken an estimate of 7% interest rate because that's what home loans are priced at right now. Now, what you'll effectively do is also get a tax benefit on the interest that you're paying. So I've netted that out. And if you remove 30% out of 7%, it's 4.9%. I've rounded it to 5% because I'm not an expert. It's easier for me to calculate like this. But if you want the exact numbers, you should get an expert to make this calculation for you. If you did that, you're at 5%. Your EMI would be about 52,000 rupees a month, every month for 20 years. Your total outgo would be 1.26 crore rupees around about, and you would pay interest of 46 lakh rupees on that loan. That is your real outgo really that's going out. The other thing to take into calculation, which I have not done because it becomes really cumbersome, is the brokerage, the maintenance, the property tax, all of these things that you will have to pay also when you make a deal like this, when you're buying a house and then selling it at the end of 20 years. So what we have right now is the amount of money that is going out of your pocket from rent vis-a-vis amount of money that will go out of your pocket if you were paying EMI. So let's take a look at what that difference would be. And if you were to invest that difference, would it actually beat real estate? What I've done to make this easier is I've taken the return on your prospective investment and the return on real estate as same. So we're just actually looking at the mathematics of it. So the down payment, remember 20 lakh rupees, you will save straight off if you rent because you don't have to put a down payment at all. So that 20 lakh rupees is there with you. You invest it, you get 8%, which you get out of the PPF if you invested in the PPF. And your total money that you will make would be about 93 lakh rupees at the end of 20 years on this 20 lakh rupees if you invested it at 8%. Monthly, you would be able to, if we deduct your EMI and your rent, you would be saving about 24,000 rupees. Even that I've taken at 8% return, what would that be? And altogether, if you see that appreciation at 8%, you would have about 1 crore rupees that you have saved from renting at the end of 20 years. If you take the value of the home at 1 crore rupees, which is what we started at, and you appreciate that at 8% every year, you have 3.6 crore rupees at the end of 20 years. So effectively, over the long term, it does make more sense to buy than to rent. But like I said, this is a complicated calculation. And it's the kind of calculation that you could do if you were making that decision, which is basically take a look at what your total rent outgo net of tax would be. Take a look at what your total EMI outgo net of tax would be, and then find out what that savings amount is and increase it by 8% every year over that period and see where you will have more money left in your hands. Now, in this particular calculation, it turns out that actually buying real estate would make more sense. But like I said, it's not the only way to make that decision. There are several other things to consider, like the flexibility, the liquidity of that asset, and of course, the emotional aspects of whether or not you should buy or rent. I do recommend that you have a financial planner or a CA break this down for you, specifically with your case, looking at the apartment or the home that you're considering, looking at the money that you're actually going to put in, looking at the return, specifically of the alternate investments that you use if you don't use real estate, and then decide what you want to do. If you have questions on this entire breakdown, do get in touch, write to us. Tell me also, if you were to make this decision, what your considerations would be and whether you are inclining or you're leaning towards buying a home right now, because it's very interesting. A lot of the articles that I've been reading lately say that people are now considering moving to larger homes, because given the whole work from home thing, kids were at home over the last 2 years, a lot of families feel that they need more space. And they also feel that they don't need to be as close to the center of the city as they used to, although now offices are opening up again. So I'm very curious to know from you whether you think you want to rent a bigger home, whether you're looking at buying a home, whether you know, you're looking at a perspective of maybe working from home for a longer period of time. Do leave us your answers in the comment section. I'm fascinated to know more about how people feel about buying a home right now. And if there's anything else you'd like us to deal with on this segment, it would be my pleasure to do so. Before I let you go, remember, shout out to Frio, which is our partner that helps us put out this show every week. Thank you so much, Frio, and thank you for watching.